chapter 1, verse 1, he says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we pray that you bless this time. Lord, I ask you just to fill me with your spirit. Lord, preach through me the words that you want us to hear. Lord, I pray that we would focus on you, we would tune the world out, and we would listen to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel is the good news of salvation. And I hope everybody in here can say, yes, I am saved without a shadow of a doubt. I know Jesus is my personal Lord and Savior, and if something were to happen to me right now, I would go to heaven. I hope each one of you can say that. And if not, you need to get with me during the invitation time or afterwards or get with somebody else and find out about the salvation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But that's what the Bible is all about. It's about salvation. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. That's eternal life. And Paul begins the book of the Romans, and he says that he was called for the gospel's sake. And we want to talk about that first. The people of the gospel. We see that Paul here is a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was called to be an apostle. And we know the story there on the Damascus Road. He was going along. He was going to get Christians to kill them. He didn't, you know, he thought he was doing God a favor. He was going to help stamp out Christianity before it ever got started. But what happened? God smote him down. And God saved his life. And he was never the same. The problem with a lot of us is when we get saved, we get over it. And folks, we don't need to get over it. If you've gotten over it, are you really truly saved? Because when you're really truly saved, you want to tell somebody else about Jesus, right? Your life changes. Paul's life changed that day on the Damascus Road. And God said, you're going to go throughout all the world, sharing the gospel, starting churches, and you're going to suffer a lot of things at the hands of these men. But his job was to go and preach the word. That's our job too. He said, well, preacher, you know, we pay you to do that, but we're all preachers. If you are a child of God, you're a preacher too. Man, woman, boy, or girl, and that's your job, is to go spread the gospel. And again, the gospel is good news. The good news about Jesus Christ coming to this earth, dying on the cross, being put in a borrowed tomb, raising again 3 days later, and ascending to the right hand of the Father. That's what it's all about. It's not about the Apostle Paul. It's not about the Old Testament prophets. It's about Jesus Christ. And that's our job. We are to go and spread that good news. We are to tell about how he was incarnate, how he left the very portals of heaven and came to this earth to die on the cross just for us. Paul said he came to the saints at Romans, or at Rome. He came to preach the word to them. He said, I wanted to come to you, and I've been hindered. So I'm writing this letter, and he said, I want to come and share some time with you. I want to impart some gifts to you, and I want to be a blessing to you, and you be a blessing to me. By the way, isn't it good to have fellowship every now and then? Last week when we had homecoming, that was some good stuff, wasn't it? We got to sit around the table and fellowship and eat, get our bellies full. There ain't nothing better than that, is there? It's good to get around Christians and to enjoy yourself. But it doesn't stop there. We're to get around lost people too and tell them about Jesus Christ and bring them into the flock, into the fold. in verses 8 through 15. He says, first I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit and the gospel of his Son. Without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making requests, if by some means now at last I may find a way in the will of God to come to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, so that you may be established. That is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith of both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often planned to come to you, but was hindered until now, that I might have some fruit among you. Also, just as the other Gentiles, I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and the unwise. So as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. He was ready to preach. He was ready to preach the gospel at a drop of a hat. He threw down the hat. That's pretty good, wasn't it? He wanted to share the gospel with everybody. You can do that. That's our job. We are to share the gospel with everybody. Sometimes we get around real important people and real rich people and stuff. We think, ooh, I might not better say something. You know, you get a little intimidated. You say, ooh, they got more money, they got more power. You know, they just, you know, I'm out of here. But folks, it don't matter who they are. We're to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Where would you be if somebody hadn't shared the gospel to you? You know? You might still be lost. That's our job. Paul said, it's a pleasure for me. He was pleased with their faith. He said, your faith is known throughout all the world. Do people know you're a Christian? If you were to be tried for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you of being a Christian? Or would they say, hey, we don't see nothing, man. Let them go. Ain't enough evidence to convict them. And I'm afraid in some of our lives that's what would happen. But he said, your faith is known throughout all of the world. They have been doing their job telling others about Jesus Christ. Their faith was known. It should be that in the office where you work, the field that you were at, whatever, the people around you, if something goes down, they say, go tell so-and-so because they know how to pray. They can get a hold of God. That's your faith going on. Because you've lived it, you've talked it, you've preached it. But it was a pleasure to Paul. It pleased him. But then he prayed for him. He said, I pray for you all the time. Do you pray for one another? Supposed to. I pray for y'all every day. Every day. I name you by name. Some of you more than once a day. He said, well, preacher, that's your job. I understand that. But it's also a privilege for me to lift you up. And that's what we're to do. You know, we are to pray for one another. He said, I make mention of you in my prayers. Not just once a week, not just once a day, but without ceasing. What does without ceasing mean? Don't stop, keep right on, that's right. And that's what we are to do for one another. And he said, I want to come to you and I want to impart some spiritual gifts or some blessing to you, and I want to be encouraged by you. So we see the people of the gospel, the preaching of the gospel, now the power of the gospel. Look at verse 16 and 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. The power of the gospel. Did you know the gospel is powerful? It's very powerful. We talked about it in Sunday school this morning. Sometimes we think, oh, that person will never get saved. They're too far gone. They're just gone. They're out there. They're just gone. We can't do it. But then people keep witnessing to them, planting seeds. And then all of a sudden they come to Christ and you're like, wow, what happened? And then we act surprised. But we shouldn't. The gospel is powerful. God can save whoever he wants to. It is powerful. He said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. The problem with our churches today, the problem with Christians today is we are ashamed of the gospel. Folks, we're not to be ashamed of the gospel. You know, do you remember when you was dating and when you was engaged, just before you got married, boy, you go up there with him or her or whatever, you was proud. You bowed that chest out, you stuck that neck out, buddy, you was proud. You know, you strutted. Looking here, this is my fiance. You know? Y'all been there, you know what I'm talking about. Huh? You was proud, you was ashamed. That's the way it is to do the gospel. And our problem is we become ashamed of the gospel. Paul didn't care where he was at, where he was at, who he was with. Whatever, kings, priests, it didn't matter. He said, hey, you need Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or you're dying and going to hell. It didn't matter to him. He preached to Felix. He preached to Agrippa. He wasn't ashamed. They put him in prison, chained him to a Roman soldier. He preached to them. He had a captive audience. Dude couldn't go nowhere. He was chained up. He was chained to Paul. I bet some of them soldiers, when their ship was up, would say, whoo, praise God, I'm glad I'm not chained to him no more. I'm tired of that. You know? Because that's all Paul talked about. You say, well, I just don't want to offend nobody. Well, you know what? Some people need offending. Where would you be if you hadn't been offended by the gospel? Paul said, I am ashamed of the gospel because it's the power to salvation. From the uttermost to the guttermost, or the guttermost to the uttermost, however you want to put it, the gospel is powerful. God can save who he wants to, and he will save who he wants to. When God calls you, you'll come. Some of you were that way. You said, ain't no way I'll ever get saved. That religious stuff, that ain't for me. But then God started working on your heart. And look at you now, sitting up in the church, worshiping the Lord, right? That's right. Hey, I was that way. I didn't want nothing to do with religion. I had my life. I was strolling along, I thought, doing pretty good, you know. As long as the drugs kept coming and all that kind of stuff, and the alcohol, the girls, and everything that I was involved in. But then one day, I got real miserable. None of that mattered to me anymore. And one night, God said, boy, you're going to die and go to hell unless you accept me as your personal Lord and Savior. And it scared me. And I said, Lord, and he had brought me down to a point where it didn't matter, whatever, Lord, I'm with you. Come into my heart. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You ever been there? You know? Now, some people got saved just by hearing a Christian song and say, you know, I am lost, I need to get saved. Some people, it takes, you know, us thick-headed people, it takes a lot. You know, God just has to keep putting it on you, putting it on you. And then finally you say, okay, or whatever, you know. Some of you may have come to church as a a little child in VBS or something and got saved that way. But folks, it doesn't matter as long as you're saved, because the gospel is powerful. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's powerful to bring people to a salvation, to the salvation knowledge. He says to the Jew first, because the Jews were God's people. They were his chosen people. And he wanted them to get saved. He wanted all of them to get saved. So he sent the gospel to them first, but they rejected him. And then that's why he called Paul. And Paul kept, when he first got saved, he was going to the Jews and going to the synagogue. And he was preaching and telling them about Jesus. And they kept trying to kill him, and they ran him out. You know, so finally he just said, I'm through with y'all. God told me to go to the Gentiles. And he went to the Gentiles and started leading people to Jesus, starting churches everywhere. And you probably can trace your salvation to Paul going to the Gentiles, because it was through that, through all the Reformation and all that, how we got the gospel. But folks, the gospel is powerful. He says, for in it, the righteousness of God is revealed. Have you ever thought about that? The righteousness of God is revealed through the gospel. You start studying the scripture, reading the scripture, and applying the scripture, you'll see how righteous God is. And then, as we'll see next week, we'll see that God's also got wrath. We'll see how wrathful he is also. But folks, he said, I would that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. God didn't have to send his one and only son to die on the cruel rugged cross so that we can be saved. But he loved us so much he did. Are you sure you're saved? Or do you know without a shadow of a doubt that you're saved? If you were to die right now, would you go to heaven? If there's any doubt in your mind, you need to nail that down. If you say, well, preacher, I don't think so, you need to be saved. Billy Graham said that he believes that at least 80% of the modern church is lost and dying, going to hell. 80%. That's a lot. That's a lot. That would be like this whole side over here being lost, and you in the back there, and Miss David moving back there, y'all being saved, the rest lost. Something similar to that is the equation. So I'm going to ask you, are you saved? It is powerful. The gospel is powerful. It will save you to the Jew first and then to the Greek. Are you saved? Do you sit there and wonder when I preach? Oh, maybe I am saved. Is it in the back of your mind nagging you all the time? Do you lay down in bed at night and try to go to sleep and is constantly on your mind? Folks, you can look around in the world today and see that time's almost up. The world's bad. It's evil this week. Jesus can part the eastern sky at any time. And if he does, will you be caught up with him, or will you be left behind? Folks, this is serious. The gospel is serious. God wants you to be saved. Make sure that you are saved. So we see the people, the salvation, the preaching of the gospel, and then the power of the gospel. Make sure that you know that you
know, as you know, without any shadow of a doubt, if something happens to you, that you're saved. As the ladies come, we're going to have a hymn of invitation. The gospel is powerful. It can save you. You say, well, preacher, you just don't know what I've done. It doesn't matter. Jesus can save you. Well, preacher, you don't know how far out there I got. It doesn't matter. Jesus can save you. Jesus can save the man on death row that committed 55 murders or 2 murders. He can save the drug addict. He can save the wino. He can save the alcoholic. He can save the harlot, the prostitute, whoever. He can save them. All you've got to do is turn to Him. Have you turned to Him? If not, you need to be saved this morning as you stand. What number are we going to sing? 201, as you stand.
Yes, remember, please, please pray today for the election. Please.